Please come to order. Good morning, welcome to the Commissioner of St. Mary's County meeting this day, Tuesday, May 15th, 2018. I am Randy Guy, President of the Commissioner of St. Mary's County. I'll introduce the other commissioners. Tom Jarbro, who represents the First Commissioner District, which includes Ridge, Piney Point, St. George Island, is joining us via teleconference. Tom, are you here?
Good morning. I'm here. Good morning.
Okay. Good. Sitting to my right, representing the Second Commissioner District, which includes Leonardtown Hollywood, Mr. Mike Hewitt.
Good morning.
John O'Connor, who represents the Third Commissioner District, which includes Charlotte Hall, 7th District, Golden Beach, and Mechanicsville, is joining us via teleconference also. John, are you on?
Good morning.
Okay, John, they're good enough. He's here. A little unusual, but it's working. Sitting to my left, representing the Fourth Commissioner District, which includes Lexington Park, Summit of California, and Great Mills, Mr. Todd Morgan. See at the end is Dr. Rebecca Bridget. She's our county administrator. On my immediate right is Bonnie Gray, our recorder for today. Amy Carter, our video media producer, is behind the glass. So when you come forward, smile, look good. You're on TV, and you'll be seeing it again this weekend. Please turn your cell phones off or on vibrate. When you come to the presenter's table, please come down, approach by coming down the center aisle. And remember, this meeting is being televised, so you need to speak clearly and directly into the microphone for recording purposes. At this time, we'll have the invocation and pledge by Commissioner Hewitt. Please stand.
Fulton Letourneau is going to do the prayer for us. I have a head cold and I have a hard time speaking. Thank you.
Please bow your heads. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you mostly for this precious day you've given us and a beautiful day. We thank you for the ceremony we had this morning at the Garvey Center and the new library. We ask to bless our county commissioners, our directors. Also, we bless and protect our law enforcement, fire and rescues. We ask to bless our citizens of St. Mary's County. And we thank you very much for this beautiful day. Thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you, folks. Please join me in the pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Commissioner Hewitt. Next, we need the approval of the consent agenda.
Mr. President, I move to approve the consent agenda, which includes the minutes of May 2018 as presented.
Second.
I have a first and second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed?
Aye.
Got all the ayes. Ayes have it. Thank you. We present has some proclamations. The first one will be for a Small Business Month. We'd like to have a few people please come forward. I know Chris Castellimus and various other economic development personnel, please come forward. And is this Catherine Grubb of owner of St. Innie's Coffee?
Yep.
Okay, good enough, good enough. Is that the one? Whereas St. Mary's County, Maryland acknowledges the contributions made by small businesses to the economic growth and quality of life locally in the state of Maryland and the United States of America, and whereas St. Mary's County's partnership with local organizations provides support for small businesses, which represents major opportunities for economic development, innovation, growth, and expansion in our community, and whereas small businesses like St. Innie's Coffee, a locally owned and operated business in Lexington Park, contributes to the economic vitality of the county, generate a large percentage of jobs in St. Mary's County, and a large majority of our small business employ fewer than five people. And whereas government contributes to small business growth through its economic growth strategy and various businesses growth incentive programs. Now therefore, we the Commissioners of St. Mary's County do hereby recognize the contributions of St. Innie's Coffee as representing an important component in the economic future of our county, and further proclaim the month of May 2018 Small Business Month, and invite all citizens to support the numerous small businesses that form the heart of St. Mary's County business community. This date, May 15, 2018. Thank you. And would you like to have some, say something?
Let me jump in first. This has been a fascinating story of economic development in St. Mary's County. And I've been watching this all along because I've been prodding and pushing, and we're working together to get St. Mary's Coffee where it is. It started off in the farmer's market down by Gate 3. And Donna Sasser's not here, but we were always looking for a little, or she's always looking for little new stores and venues to come in at the farmer's market. I go there every Saturday morning. So one Saturday morning, she says, "We're going to get a coffee company." I say, "You're going to do what?" So in walks Catherine, and she sits in the very back right-hand corner, and they make their own coffee down at their house down in San Diego's. They roast it in the back and come in with their fresh brewed coffee. They have like five or six different flavors. So we're sitting there, and we're talking about she wants to expand. Where do you want to expand to? Lexington Park. I said, where? She says, on Shangri-La Drive, and those old little round buildings there sort of across from the church. Where? She says, it's a great idea, Todd. So we talk about it, and then it's like, okay, what are we going to do? Well, Todd, think about all the traffic that goes up and down Willis Road every day. Think about the library there. Think about people who can walk there and have little reading rooms and stuff. So we start thinking. They're doing all the thinking. I'm doing all the listening. Okay, so I said, good idea. So what eventually became a dream then became a reality. Now, it took some work also from the county departments to help us out to make it work. But you got to go there today. And you walk in there today on a Saturday morning, or not Sunday, but weekday mornings, and if you want to read books, it's like watching the library book sale for free. Bring books, bring all the books in. And you come in, and you have on the right side, you have little lounges set up, and people in there doing Wi-Fi, and they're reading books. But you go on the left, it's a place for little kids and mothers to come. And the mothers come in, they can read their books, they have little parties in there for everybody, and you go and you have your coffee, and they have little danishes and pastries. It's really a wonderful success story. And I want to thank you guys for everything you've done to make success story, because a lot of people didn't believe it could happen, including me, but once you saw the vision, and you saw the results, so not only now do we serve coffee in the farmer's market every Saturday morning, but now we have Sandy's Coffee operating every Saturday morning too, all throughout the county. Everybody wants to walk, run up and down Willis Road. Go in there. The coffee is absolutely delicious. And what's really cool about it, each cup is poured individually. They have a little machine. They put a little thing there. They dump their coffee in. They pour the water. It drips down. It's great. And Rocky is going to have it.
How much are you charging for that? I'm gonna get on this. No, go ahead.
I just wanted to say we really couldn't have done it without the support of Todd and a lot of the offices in St. Mary's County opening it. And of course, all of our customers from the market have kind of moved over and spread the word. And we're just really grateful to be able to be serving that community in Lexington Park, and hope to be able to serve you all coffee soon as well.
Great. I got to get down there.
Yeah.
I have to.
Thank you.
Anything?
No. She's boss. She's a boss.
Very good. Make sure that they time to participate, go down and try it out. It's not a good idea to me.
Mm-hmm.
And I'll have to try it out. Thank you.
Thank you, guys.
Okay, we got to get you in front here enough for official photo.
Oh.
Right in front of the desk. You get right in the center.
On the other side.
Okay. Is that what we call our
official? Come on,
Mary. We call our official. No, get over to the side.
Hold your proclamation up, Captain. And she does it on the county seal too, signed by me.
Thank you.
Good, I gotta get down there. Thank you for the hard work. And okay, next we have a proclamation for National Transportation Week. And so Mr. Dietrich and all of his group, please come forward. Hornier, Blankenship, Brown, whoever is part of it. Oh, everybody come on up. Come on. Anything to do with transportation. All right.
Hello.
Thank you for being here.
Thank you.
Thank you for coming. Thank you.
Who wants to hold the proclamation?
John, come on.
So a proclamation dated on our National Transportation Week. It says, Whereas the week of May 14th and 19th, 2018 marks the nation's 66th annual National Transportation Week celebration and provides an opportunity to raise awareness about public transportation and its benefits by encouraging citizens to utilize public transit systems. On May 16th, 1957, Congress approved the third Friday in May each year as National Defense Transportation Day. In 1962, Congress updated the request to include the whole week as National Transportation Week to celebrate the community of transportation professionals who keep our county moving. Whereas, on March 10, 2018, the National American Public Transportation Association launched We're Where Public Transportation Goes, Communities Grow campaign, which seeks to effectively brand public transportation in today's realities and reposition efforts to communicate to a wider community about public transportation. And whereas special events to be held throughout the week include the distribution of STS passenger appreciatums to transit bus riders on May 14th to 15th, Veterans Ride All Day Free Dollar events on May 16th to 17th, Driver of the Year recognition on May 17th, Ride All Day for a Dollar promotion days on May 18th and 19th to encourage ridership, STS driver, mechanic crew appreciation on May 17th, and Stop the Bus events on May 19th to help replenish local food banks and with non-perishable food. And whereas the Department of Public Works and Transportation also celebrate the American Public Transportation Association's 13th annual National Dump the Pump Day with public transportation systems across the country on June 21st. Now, therefore, we, the Commissioners of St. Mary's County, do hereby proclaim the week of May 14th to 19th, 2018, National Transportation Week in St. Mary's County, and encourage all citizens to use public transportation as it is an important part of our nation's transportation system and provides an affordable and, for many, necessary alternative to driving today, May 15th, 2018. I have my mouth full, now it's yours.
Well, this is an exciting week to do a lot of advertising for St. Mary's Transit System. Mm-hmm. As you mentioned, we do have a lot of dollar a day events, Veterans Ride All Day for Dollar events. We're having a Driver Mechanic Appreciation Day also, and we're giving out lots of appreciation items for our passengers that ride the bus, and we're hoping we get more passengers out there. We want you to ride the buses. For a dollar 50, you can go throughout the county connecting with Charles and St. Mary's County.
Great. Why don't you tell everybody how many rides you provide a year? I think that will stagger them.
347,000 plus. And then we have ADA transportation, correct, which is over 6,000, mm-hmm, and our specialized transportation, which is over 4,000.
Great.
So we're out there running. We're doing the best we can. If you need help, call 301-475-4200, star 1120.
Great.
And then anybody else?
John?
Yeah. I just want to say, coming in here to St. Mary's County, I wondered, you know, a bus system in a rural area, how are they going to do it? They do an incredible job. And we're working to make it better every day. Some excellent new buses. If any of you rode some of our buses that had over 500,000 miles on it, mm-hmm, we have new ones now.
Yeah.
And thanks to the commissioners as well as MTA. So thank you for your support, commissioners, for the system. It's an absolutely vital piece of transportation for many people who don't have cars, but it's the transportation of choice for the smart ones that know they can save money. Thank you.
Great job.
I'd just like to add that Aging and Human Services is just very pleased to be a partner in Stuff the Bus Community Food Drive again this year. Our role in this effort is to coordinate with our local pantries, to recruit volunteers, and of course to coordinate with our local grocery stores. So the donation sites will be Giant in California, and the McKay's in Leonardtown, and of course the Food Lion in Charlotte Hall. So this year, as in previous years, our slogan is always, everyone can make a difference, one can at a time. So we want to, I can't help with that. So.
Great.
Thank you, everybody. Thank you, commissioners.
You're very welcome.
And I just want to add a little reminder that throughout the county, different agencies, boxes have been placed. So please check your pantries, go shopping, and stuff the boxes. And there's one out here in the lobby. So county employees, check out your pantries and help us out.
Thank you. Good. Hey, we don't want all you on the front of the desk here, the front, to get an official photo. This will be an official photo. Is this for the?
This is, yes.
Oh, wow.
Thank you. Thank you. Next, we have a retirement ceremony. Grace Brady. Here's a little memento put on the fireplace, whatever. Yeah, okay. You can hold this at the same time or not.
Okay.
Whereas on January 17, 2007, Grace Mary Brady began her employment with St. Mary's County Government as an administrative assistant to the county administrator. On July 14, 2008, she transferred to the Department of Land Use and Growth Management as a permits specialist too. She received a promotion to Planner 2, Historic, on March 9, 2009. On July 1, 2015, she was reclassified as Planner 3, Historic. And whereas Grace Mary Brady will retire from her employment with St. Mary's County Government on June 1, 2018, and whereas Grace Mary Brady has merited the love and respect of countless friends, family, and coworkers over the course of her career. Now, therefore, we, the Commissioners of St. Mary's County, do hereby express our appreciation to Grace Mary Brady for many years of service. We extend sincere congratulations to her on this occasion of her retirement and best wishes for many more years of happiness and ask God's blessing upon her. This date, May 15, 2018. Thank you very much.
Oh, yeah. Nice try, dude.
You gotta say a few things.
I just really have enjoyed my job in St. Mary's County tremendously. It's hard to leave because it's very hard to leave a job that you look forward to going to every day. But I think it's nice to go out on top of your game. And I think it's nice to go out when you're healthy enough to go travel and enjoy some trips and your family and friends. So thank you very much. I really truly have enjoyed being here.
And you don't know how much the community appreciates everything that you've done for us behind the scenes, in front of us, but you're a legend.
Thanks.
Okay, next we're going into the Department of Land Use Growth Management public hearing, proposed amendment to ordinance number 2017-15 to provide an exemption to the impact fee ordinance for replacement dwelling units under certain conditions. Wait one second. We will now open the public hearing, proposed to amend the ordinance number 2017-15 to provide an exemption to the impact fee ordinance for replacement dwellings units under certain conditions. Sign-in sheets were provided up front. If you have not signed in and wish to speak, we ask that you sign in now.
We will now have a presentation from Mr. Bill Hunt, who is the Director of Department of Land Use Growth Management, Harry Knight, who's Permits Coordinator, Department of Land Use Growth Management, and Mr. David Weisskopf, if needed, our Acting County Attorney, if needed. We will now open the hearing for public comments. First, Bill, make the presentation.
Commissioners, Dr. Bridget, this is a public hearing to amend the impact fee ordinance to provide exemptions under certain circumstances. The legal ad for this public hearing was published in the Enterprise on April 27th and May 4th. The impact fee ordinance that was in effect in St. Mary's County from the year 2000 to July 27 had an exemption for the replacement of legally existing habitable dwellings. A new ordinance that was adopted in 2017 changed the exemption to only apply to dwellings for which an impact fee had previously been paid. The amendment before you today proposes adding exemptions for three situations. These are: a development impact fee would not be required for the issuance of a building permit to replace an existing or previously existing dwelling for which a development impact fee was previously paid. One impact fee and only one impact fee has to be paid for a dwelling. This is the 2017 exemption. The second one is a development impact fee would not be required for the issuance of a building permit to replace an existing dwelling which was built before the first impact fee ordinance, which was adopted in 1974. A dwelling built before the county adopted an impact fee can be replaced without paying an impact fee. However, the dwelling must be existing at the time the building permit to replace the dwelling is applied for. This exemption does not apply if a dwelling was legal before 1974 but was demolished and does not exist at the time a building permit for a new dwelling is applied for. So in other words, apply first before you demolish to take advantage of that exemption. And then the third one, a development impact fee is not required for the issuance of a building permit to replace a previously existing dwelling which was lost to fire, accident, or natural disaster within the last 3 years. This exemption applies to a dwelling that never paid an impact fee but is destroyed through an accident, but the building permit must be applied for within 3 years of the dwelling being lost. The public record for this public hearing closes on Tuesday, May 22nd, and the vote on the decision is expected on Tuesday, June 5th.
Commissioners, any questions on?
So basically what we're trying to do is clean up a little bit of the ordinance so that the people who are impacted aren't paying a double impact fee essentially at the end of the day.
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Any other questions, Commissioner? Okay, we will now open the hearing for public comment. We ask that you keep remarks to 3 minutes. At this time, I have no speakers who signed up, but anyone out there in the audience would like to speak at this time concerning this change in the impact fee, you may come forward. Going once, going twice. No speakers. Close. That is all who have signed up to speak today. No one. Is there anyone in the audience? We already went through that. Commissioners of St. Mary's County will receive public comments on this matter for an additional 7 days. Comments should be mailed to the Commissioners of St. Mary's County at P.O. Box 653, Leonardtown, Maryland 20650, or email to csmc@stmarysmaryland.com. We will now close public hearing for public comments and close the public hearing. Switching books. We just did that. No, that's just H. Okay. Okay. Okay, next we have the Department of Land Use Growth Management, but it's Historic Preservation Month Awards. Will you please, those who participated, please come forward and start it. She's going to read it. We're all going to go up here and read off the mic.
Good morning, everyone. Is this the one? Thank you.
Every year, the Historic Preservation Commission for St. Mary's County selects and awards in the field of Historic Service Award, Historic Project Award, or Lifetime Achievement Award. This year, the board selected six entities to receive an award. The first award goes to Jack and Cindy Pratt, and how we work this so that everybody in the group will know is I'll call your name, you come up, the commissioners will read a proclamation to you. Carol Moody, who is the chair of the Historic Preservation Commission, will give you an award, and then they have you up front for a photo opportunity. So could we have Jack and Cindy Pratt, who were nominated by Kathy Bailey to receive a Preservation Project Award for the complete restoration of Lower Notley Hall.
Whereas historic preservation enhances the quality of life and gives
local residents a greater understanding of the richness and diversity of their cultural and architectural heritage. And whereas Lower Notley Hall Farm is located on property that has passed through many hands, starting with the Native American Indians to Maryland's first proprietary colonial governor, Thomas Notley, in the 17th century. And whereas Lower Notley Hall is the late 19th century home, which was the childhood home of departed local author and historian Robert E.T. Pogue, and whereas due to the efforts of Jack and Cindy Pratt, the house has been completely restored inside and out, along with the complete restoration of the three-story staircase, which is embellished by hand-carved moldings. And whereas Jack and Cindy Pratt offer Lower Notley Farm as a venue for colonial and Victorian weddings on the Wicomico River. Now therefore, we the Commission of St. Mary's County do hereby award a 2018 St. Mary's County Historic Preservation Project Award to Jack and Cindy Pratt, this date, May 15, 2018. Thank you very much. Either one of you have a piece of paper to speak?
Well, I don't really know what to say other than thank you. This was unexpected, but it certainly is nice. We are trying so hard to keep this homestead in the family for our children as well. It was getting a little sore to look at, and decided they needed a little love. There's still work to do. There will always be work to do. But my great uncle, Robert Pogue, who wrote Yesterday in St. Mary's County, he loved that house so much. It's the house that he talked about in the book. So if you get a chance to reread it, you can hear more details about it and enjoy the words that he had to say about the people who lived there and the house that he loved. Thank you.
Great, thank you. Thank you very much. The official photo. There we go.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, the next nomination was our own MedStar St. Mary's Hospital. They were nominated by St. Mary's County Historical Society for a Preservation Service Award. And if we could have Holly Meyer, Ruby Hawks, Nikki Strickland, and Carol Nelson come forward representing MedStar Hospital, please. St. Mary's Hospital.
Come on, Dr. Roach.
Come on, Dr. Roach. You can come up here twice today.
Whereas historic preservation enhances the quality of life and gives local residents a greater understanding of the richness and diversity of their cultural and archaeological heritage. And whereas the hospital was established in Leonardtown in 1912. And whereas prior to the hospital's 100th anniversary, the facility staff recommended the creation of a history room to the hospital's administration. And whereas on October 26, 2017, the MedStar St. Mary's History Room Reflections Open was dedicated to John W. Roach, M.D., retired surgeon, local historian, and current president of the St. Mary's County Historical Society. And whereas the Reflections exhibit is conveniently located on the first floor of the hospital between the chapel and the dining area, and is available to visitors 24 hours a day. Now, therefore, we, the Commissioners of St. Mary's County, do hereby award the 2018 St. Mary's County Historic Preservation Service Award to MedStar Hospital, MedStar St. Mary's Hospital, this date, May 15th, 2018. Who did I speak, besides Dr. Roach?
Well, I think that this project was a very special project to recognize the contributions of the people of the community of St. Mary's that made this hospital what it is, and that gets lost in all of the modern times. And those people should be remembered. And if anybody has the opportunity to slip in there and visit, it's a very peaceful, a very private, a very special spot. And it's a time. Yep, that's it. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Okay.
Okay. Sure. Actually, the hours of the Reflections Room is 8 a.m. to 8 p.m. And it was a group of people who came together to help make it happen. So we wanted to recognize Linda Lagel. Okay, it's open 24 hours. Linda Lagel couldn't be here today, but she was critical in making the History Room happen. She did a lot of research to pull it together and get all the history that we have saved and history from the community that was donated to us to make it the special place that it is.
Great.
Thank
good.
You. Good. We need everybody in the front.
All in favor, official photos. Just scoot on down. Just hold that phone. How's that?
Great.
Thank you. Thank you all very much.
Thank you.
Okay, our next award is on behalf of the Drayden African American Schoolhouse Project. It was a preservation project award. It goes to Donald and Christine Kropp, Christine could not be here today, but I know Donald is here. And I'd also like to call representatives Karen Stone, Jeanette Pettit, Arthur Shepherd, April Heavens, and Lynn Futrell up front, please.
Ms. Kropp, thank you for all your hard work.
My dad.
Hope I'm going to get you to hold this. Whereas historic preservation enhances the quality of life and gives local residents a greater understanding of the richness and diversity of their culture and architectural heritage. And whereas in 2015, Donald and Christine Kropp, whose love for history and giving back to the community prompted them to donate funds, materials, and services needed for the completed renovation of the Drayden African American Schoolhouse. And whereas due to the efforts of Donald and Christine Kropp, the schoolhouse has been given a new roof, stable foundation, a new door, and has been completely repainted inside and out. And whereas Donald and Christine Kropp were also be able to outfit the schoolhouse with historically appropriate furnishings to bring this once active location back to life. Now therefore, we, the Commissioner of St. Mary's County, do hereby award a 2018 St. Mary's County Historic Preservation Project Award to the Donald and Christine Kropp, this date, May 15, 2018. Thank you. Sure. Well, sir, do you have some words of wisdom you want to?
No, I really enjoyed doing it. It was kind of fun putting it together, and hope everybody comes and visits.
We did a lot of hard work. There's a lot of your own personal time that you put into it. And we really appreciate this community to keep this preservation of our history together. You did an outstanding job.
I've stopped out in evenings.
Well, I know you did. I'm sure you did. Yeah, no. That's what I heard. I didn't see it. But, well, thank you very much. Anybody else have anything? Okay, we need to get out.
Maureen. The Hen Coop Cemetery, Maureen Norton was nominated for a Preservation Service Award. Would you come up front, please, Ms. Norton?
Whereas historic preservation enhances the quality of life and gives local residents a greater understanding of the richness and diversity of their cultural and archaeological heritage. Whereas the Hen Coop Cemetery is a 19th century cemetery located on land formerly owned by the Langley family and is now part of Point Lookout State Park after being purchased by the Maryland Department of Natural Resources. Whereas Maureen Norton contacted local elected officials, the Maryland Department of Natural Resources, and the Historical Preservation Commission to get the cemetery cleaned up and the tombstones repaired. And whereas due to efforts of Maureen Norton and members of the Historic Preservation Commission and archaeologists of Southern Maryland, volunteers began a systematic cleanup of the cemetery. Whereas Maureen Norton was instrumental in preserving the cemetery along with its valuable genealogical information. Now therefore, we, the Commissioners of St. Mary's County, do hereby award the 2018 St. Mary's Historic Preservation Service Award to Maureen Norton, the state, May 15, 2018. Would you like to say a few words?
This is so undeserved. I'm just tearing up because Hen Coop is so special to me. I have so many helpers, neighbors that came and helped us clean up, and I want to thank the rangers also at the park. I had at least 5 rangers come on 2 separate times, and we're still cleaning it up, and anybody that wants to come help, there's a lot of work to do. I'm really going to still work, however, and I'll get serious with the state, because we need help from the state to really rectify the problems at the Hen Coop Cemetery and to get some permission to right these stones to make this a respectful site. It is not respectful at this time, and that's what I'd like to do. God bless you.
Well, we'll try to help you work that through the state level.
I just have one question.
Yes.
Are there any chickens buried down there?
I have no idea what the name is. But I also wanted to thank Scott Lawrence, who is no longer with us. He helped me so much to understand the project. Thank you.
Good. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you for all your hard work. How are you doing? Please continue. Let us know if we can help you out, please.
Okay, Historic Soderly Plantation was nominated by Eve Love to receive a Preservation Service Award. So could I have Nancy Easterling, Bert Johnson, Lynn Fertrell, Eve Love come up, and this is for the Resurrection Manor exhibit.
Back up.
Back up again. Whereas historic preservation enhances the quality of life and gives local residents a greater understanding of the richness and diversity of their cultural and architectural heritage, and whereas Resurrection Manor was built on a 4,000-acre farm granted to Thomas Cornwallis, is that the same way? Cornwallis?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
In 1605, and whereas Resurrection Manor was a rare example of early brick architecture in the United States dating from 1660 to 1720. And was listed as a National Historic Landmark in 1970. And whereas Historic Soderly created a new exhibit telling the story of neglect
with the hopes of raising awareness of all the irreplaceable culture, historical, and architectural sites still remain in St. Mary's County. And whereas this exhibit also tells the stories of the families who inhabited Resurrection Manor until the 1930s, after which it sat empty and uncared for until it was demolished in November 2002. Now therefore, we, the Commission of St. Mary's County, do hereby award the 2018 St. Mary's County Historic Preservation Service Award to Historic Sodaly this date, May 15, 2018. Something you
want to
say?
Yeah, this exhibit, our third permanent exhibit at Sodaly, is different because you heard the words Resurrection Manor. You weren't hearing the words Sodaly. Mm-hmm. We had a big panel from Resurrection Manor in our ICE house. How it got there, I don't know. Some questions you don't ask. But a panel was saved and preserved there. And the thought was, we need to remember that places like Resurrection Manor, if we don't save those stories, they're lost forever. Parts of our past, our connection to the past, are lost forever. And the Sodaly has a connection with Resurrection Manor. It didn't actually own the manor itself. It did have a connection with the land. This exhibit, when you come in and you come to see Sodaly, we have three permanent exhibits now. This one, located in our warehouse, gives that little bit of that story and what can happen if you don't try to reach out and protect it. The stories that can be lost forever that we won't have that connection with. And that's why it's called the Urgency of Preservation. So it's an honor to have this award recognizing how important historic preservation is. There are stories and our past help us look toward the future and we need to preserve that.
Well said. Okay, let's move to the front of the desk here to get some official
photograph here.
Our final award today goes to the St. Mary's County Historical Society, the Board of Directors, to receive a Preservation Service Award. So, Dr. Roach, if you could come up again. Chris, you're quite popular today, sir. Chris, Denise, and Susan Wolf.
Where historic preservation enhances the quality of life and gives local residents a greater understanding of the richness and diversity of their culture and archaeological heritage. And whereas the St. Mary's County Historical Society was established in Leonardtown in 1951, and whereas 5 years ago the Board of Directors of the St. Mary's Historical Society created an annual series of programs focusing on the 380 plus years of county history titled Ordinary People, Extraordinary Accomplishments. And whereas the first four programs are St. Mary's County Rye, Whiskey, and Bootlegging, Tobacco Production and Its Demise, Oysters from the 18th to the 21st Century, and Stores as Community Centers. And whereas each of these programs can be viewed at the St. Mary's County Historical Society. Now therefore, we, the Commissioners of St. Mary's County, do hereby award a 2018 St. Mary's County Historic Preservation Service Award to the St. Mary's County Historical Society this date, May 15, 2018.
When our board of directors first came up with this idea, it was to talk about the people of the county, how they make the county unique. And we came up with the first program, but from then on, participants have voted for what the programs are. We have close to 700 members that live in 35 states across the country and two in Canada who have a love for this county. So they're all voting now on what we're doing. Last Friday night, we did it on Hoofbeats Through History. Horses in the county since 1634. We now have 18 topics that people are voting on for next year. Mm-hmm. So this is a series we will continue.
Great. That's great. That's absolutely great.
Very good.
Anybody else?
I think that when we realize that this great nation was established by 13 original colonies, and one of those 13 original colonies was right down here in St. Mary's County. And as Ms. Easterling has already related, we forget this history. It gets overrun. And too many people know nothing about our history. And our historical preservation and our recognition of these things is so very important. It's going to be lost if we don't. If you get where you came from, you don't have any idea where the hell you're going. Thank you very, very much.
Everybody right in the front here so we can get an official photo.
Okay, in closing, I'd like to recognize four of the Historic Preservation members who are here today. Carol Moody is our chair. We have Eve Love, Teresa Wilson, and Sean Wickers. If you have an interest in history or historic preservation, we have a vacancy on the board, which will come up in June, which is only 3 weeks away. So if you think you'd like to be appointed to the Historic Preservation Commission Board, please contact Diane in the county attorney's office and fill in your application for consideration. Thank you very much for attending our award ceremony today. Thank you.
Give them 2 minutes to get out.
Yeah. We'll give everybody a couple of minutes to, we're changing programs here now. 2 minute break.
are you today?
I'm actually up in Sykesville.
Recess time is over. Please come to order. Next, we have the Department of Finance. Rich St. Mary's County sets the rates and approves 2019 operating and capital budgets. Presented by Jeanette Cudmore, our Chief Financial Officer, and Patty Sigmund, our Deputy Director. Thank you for being here.
Good morning, Commissioners, and thank you. Took a while to get here, but we're here, and I'll go ahead and start going through the package and working my way through, and should you have any questions as we go along, just let me know. Okay? So we'll go and start on page one. Again, we have our revenue ordinance first. There's actually, the revenue includes all of the revenues that are for the county. And, you know, we talk about the semi-annual payment for the property taxes, you know, for making the two payments. There's a fee, 0.39%, which is approved by the state, actually. Income tax levy, the fuel and energy tax, the special tax rate levy. And then we go to page four, where we start setting the rates. So the first item on page four is the levy of emergency services tax rates. And you can see, as proposed, the rates that are there for the fire tax rates. And these rates in this ordinance actually include the proposed rates. And the rescue rates are on page five. Okay. And then going to page six, we've got the levy of the energy and the fuel tax. That's 1.25% energy charge. Then we have the levy of the district tax rates on below that. And back to page five, we've got the levy of the county income tax rates at 3%. And then where do we have the income? The property tax is 0.8478 with no change. From there, we turn on page eight, which is our appropriation ordinance, which really outlines all of the different appropriations for county departments, starting on page eight. Elected officials, state independent agencies and independent boards, and other government costs on page nine. Page 10, we talk about the reserves, the enterprise and special revenue funds, and then we start into the capital improvement fund appropriations, and we list each project that's included in the CIP for FY 2019. And end up on page 12 with the public school projects. And also on page 13, it approves actually the plan going out to FY 2024 for the CIP. Page 14, we have the amend the ordinance for the solid waste environmental fee, changing it from $72 to $91. Page 18 is to repeal and replace ordinance 2004-19 to set the building permit fees. And these fees don't actually go into effect until December 31st. Is that December 1st?
December 1st.
December 1st, thanks, Patty. And then on page 21, the other remaining fees that were for land use and growth management, and the combination of those two fees is approximately $140,000 increase in revenue. And that continues through page 26. And then we have our approved and capital budgets fiscal year page, which is what goes into our approved budget book that's signed by the county commissioners. All right, starting on 28, you can see the summary, the 2019 approved budget summary, which starts at the top of the general fund at $230,155,443. Then we have our enterprise funds, our special revenue funds, and other operating funds for independent boards. And down below that is the capital projects funds at $58.7 million. On 29, we start with our budget highlights, the 2019 approved operating budget. Your budget's at $230 million. This is $8.8 million higher, or 4% more than the FY 2018 budget. You accomplished a lot this year. This is comprised of the revenues of $228 million, a 3% increase, and the use of fund balance of $2,085,000. Your real property tax rate is recommended to be 0.8478 and is included in here. We use, again, the information from the state to calculate from the assessments. Your St. Mary's County income tax rate remains at 3%, and you used a 3.5% growth over the tax year 2016. And we also added $1 million, was added last week, or to include for the federal tax law changes. Page 30, your other local taxes increased by 8.4% to a total of $9.4 million. Highway user totaled $1.6 million, and of that, $854,000 is non-recurring, is a grant from the state. Charges for services revenue has increased $275,085 to $3.1 million in the 19 budget. Your state and federal taxes went up at $7.9 million and 8.6% higher than the prior year. The fund balance. Everybody talks about our fund balance. We've got the $30.3 million unassigned. That's from the June 30, 2017 audit. In this budget, you're planning to use $1,085,000 of the unassigned general fund balance is included in the FY 2019 adopted budget for CIP PACO for the public administration enterprise software upgrade, $1 million, and the public safety computer-aided dispatch replacement enhancement project of $85,000. These projects are planned through FY 2021, and the use of unassigned general fund balance is planned in FY 2020 for $2 million and 2021 another $2 million. And then $1 million is also being used in this for school safety needs for 2019. Page 31, we go into our expenses. County departments, we're adding 9.2 positions, 2.5 in the Department of Aging and Human Services. Changing the tourism, going from contracted services, and reducing their positions by 2. Department of Public Works and Transportation has an increase of 8 positions. 5 hourly employee positions were added, and also includes 1 new position in the Emergency Services Department, Chief of Communications. And a merit increase is included for full and regular part-time employees. On the bottom, the Sheriff's Office is currently at $1.8 million over the FY 2018. It includes an increase in their pension going rate from 39 to 40%, and also ranks. Boards and state agencies on 32. The Board of Education's funding from the county totals $103,852,525, $1.5 million more than the state mandated maintenance of effort. MOE is based on the MSDE official enrollment of 17,154.75, which was an increase of 27.25 students. The recurring funding for the Board of Education is increased by $1.6 million over FY 2018. The library includes funding increase of $77,000 and continues the 50% share of costs for the local ESTAT office. Debt service is increased by $412,000, partially due to the bonds that are being sold in July and August for the interest, and then the use of the June 30, again, unassigned fund balance is $2,085,000. If you look at page 33, we have our pie chart here. You can see the biggest revenues in the county's budget is property taxes at 47.98% and local income tax at 40.8%. Page 34 is your summary of the revenues, and then your detail starts on 35. If you go to page 40, there's our general fund expenditures, and you can see the biggest share is 45.12%, and that includes grants for the Board of Education. The next is departments and elected officials for 23.28%, and the sheriff's office is at 17.57%. Debt service is 5.07%. We have the summary of expenditures on page 41. And you can see county departments are increasing by 4.7%, elected officials are 4.8%, boards and state agencies at 1.7%. Your debt service is increasing 3.7%. And then the details start on page 42. Your multi-year budget is on page 59. and includes in its balance through FY 2023. There are extra revenues for the outgoing years. Recreation and Parks Enterprise Fund is on 60. 61 is the Wicomico Shores Golf Enterprise Fund. Solid Waste and Recycling Fund, page 62, with that new rate of $91. Miscellaneous Revolving Fund is on page 63. Special Assessments Fund is on 64. The Emergency Services Support Fund is on 65. The Fire Tax and Rescue Taxes are on page 66 and 67. Starting on page 68, we have your approved capital budget for 2019. And it's for $58.7 million. And the use, the funding sources for this CIP is $30.2 million for bonds, transfer tax of 5.1, impact fees of $320,000, PAYGO of $1.9 million, state and federal taxes at $19.9 million, and other funding at $1 million. Then we go to the five-year plan for the CIP, starting on 70. And you can see that the different funding types are also on page 71. So the total is summary by project type, and then the summary by sources is at the bottom. Page 72 is our operating impacts, which were updated based on discussion last week. Moving out some positions. Debt capacity is on page 73. You're well within your affordability measures. Your outstanding debt as a percent base is ranging from 1.57% in 2019 and goes out to 2.09%. And again, this includes the debt of Metcom. Your debt service as a percent of revenues in FY 2019 is 5.515% and goes out to 6% in 2024. And this is a percentage you'd like to keep below 10%. So you're well within. Page 74 are the changes in positions. And again, you're adding 9.2 positions compared to past years. This is a lot, and this is a good job in helping the county departments. And also ranks are included for the sheriff's office. Page 75 is a schedule of pay differentials, premium pay, and insurance premiums. And on here at the bottom, it does include a 1% COLA for your hourly employees on the H scale and a one-step merit increase for regular county employees. Page 76 are the grants match for the FY 2019. See, they're broken out by department, project numbers, and the types of grant and the funding, whether they're federal or state funding. And that's your entire package. And the motions, there are 8 motions.
Well, let's start with number 1.
Okay.
I move that we approve and execute the ordinance to amend Chapter 223 of the St. Mary's of the Code of St. Mary's County, Maryland, to provide for and set the environmental and solid waste service fee.
Second.
Second.
Thank you out there.
Okay, we have a first and a second. Before we go any further, since we have 2 that are on speakerphone, I really want a roll call vote to be established, so each person please name and yes or no on your vote.
Commissioner President Guy, discussion.
Yes, sir.
What specifically does this change? What will the citizens expect? A fee of what to a fee of what?
Going from a fee of $72 to $91.
Okay. So an increase of $19 a year.
Correct. We have a first and a second. Commissioner Jarbo, your vote, please.
Aye.
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 Commissioner O'Connor?
Yes.
Yes. Commissioner Hewitt?
No.
Mr. Morgan?
Yes.
And I vote yes. That's 4-1.
Okay. Motion number 2. I move that we approve and execute the ordinance to amend Chapter 223 of the Code of St. Mary's County, Maryland, to provide for and set the schedule of fees.
O'Connor.
Is that Jarbo said second?
Yes, we both did, but you can put Jonna down, it's fine.
Okay. I have a first and a second. Commissioner Jarbo, your vote?
Yes.
Yes. Commissioner O'Connor?
Yes.
Commissioner Hewitt?
No.
Nope. Commissioner Morgan?
Yes.
Commissioner Guy, yes. Motion carried.
Motion 3, I move that we approve and execute the ordinance to repeal and replace Ordinance 2004-19 and to set the building permit fees in St. Mary's County, Maryland.
Second.
Second by Jarbo.
I was ahead of you.
I have a first and a second. Need a vote? Commissioner Jarbo?
Yes.
Commissioner O'Connor?
Yes.
Commissioner Hewitt?
Yes.
Yes. Commissioner Morgan?
Yes.
Yes. Commissioner Guy? Yes. 5 yeses. Motion carried.
Motion 4. I move to approve and authorize the new tax rate for the Lexington Park Volunteer Rescue Squad.
Second.
Seconded by Mr. Jarbo.
It ain't working, fellas.
I have a first and a second. Commissioner Jarbo, your vote?
Yes.
Commissioner O'Connor?
Yes.
Commissioner Hewitt?
Yes.
Morgan?
Yep.
Mr. Guy, yes. 5 yeses. Motion carried.
I move to approve and authorize the new tax rate for the 2nd and 9th District Volunteer Fire Department and Rescue Squad. Commissioner O'Connor.
Second.
Second, Mr. Jarbo.
Who cares? Give it to him.
Okay. Okay, we'll give Commissioner Jarbo a second this time. Okay, we got a first and a second. Any discussion?
I have it. I can support this tax increase to cover the operational deficit. I can support a new building, but I can't support it at this point. The problem with the building, in my opinion, is it does not have enough cost certainty. We've heard rates of $8 million to as high as $11 million. And I don't think it's fair that people need to pay additional taxes not knowing what they're going to receive. Now, they're not going to be able to build this building for at least a year and a half. We could postpone. I would support a 50% increase in this tax, but not the full. I think what they told us was it's about 60% operational and 40% for the new building. I would say that it's not fair to people to ask them to pay more when they don't know exactly what they're getting. So I know we have a motion and a second, but I will not support it.
I will comment also, since this is tied partially to my district. And much of what Commissioner Hewitt says is entirely correct. This fight's been going on, and I use the word fight literally, for 8 years that I've sat here. And the building is not sized correctly in my mind, but you have two groups of individuals down there that are just diametrically opposed. They just don't want to sit down and work it out. I will say, however, that I think that the responsibility for this action is going to have to fall on this board. And we're going to have to either vote it up or vote it down. And quite frankly, I really don't want to bring this back next year and the fight starts all over again. And I think former Commissioner Dan really said it best to me here some time ago. It's time to start a healing process. And I think that those people who want the new firehouse down there and those people who don't want the new firehouse should go down to Betty Russell's, sit in the corner and work this out over a beer, not the Beans house up the street or not at somebody else down the street. Just sit down at Betty Russell's in the corner and try to work this thing out for the best for all the citizens of St. Mary's County. And for that reason, I'm going to support this, but I'll be watching it very closely next term because what can be given can be taken away.
I too have reservations because I don't have enough data to qualify to build this new house yet. We don't have, I support Mr. Hewitt on too broad a range between what it costs. I definitely think we need to have an increase to cover their operating cost and maybe give a little so they have a cushion to start whatever it is for the architectural reviews and to get more information on what is this going to cost. We have a couple of years, they were planning on a 2020, so we got a few years to work on this, and if appropriate raises needed in the later years to this building, And my proposal is that we change the rate. I know right now we're going to 5.6 for both second election district and ninth election district to 5.6. I'd like to see it go to 5.0. And then also on the rescue tax, rather than going to 1.7 on both of them, go to 1.1. Now what this would do is reduce about 15% of that outlay they were talking about as far as for building resources. And it's something we can look at and pass and still have more than enough money for their operating costs. I want the people in the second district not just to understand that the people who work in these projects and trying to, and your boards there and everything, you have not had an increase in your fire and rescue tax for 17 years. I fault the board for not having an increase sooner than this, but that's the way it is. They need the operating. We got to give them the operating costs. They have to have that increase. The building now, I think we need a little more study. Personally, I need more study on to get a really firm cost on what it's going to cost them to go through with this. So my view is I'd like to have a reduction. I cannot support the present rate as it's going forward. Okay, Mr. Well, Jarboe, do you have any concessions?
I'd like to add, but yeah, this is Commissioner O'Connor here. I have a couple reservations. I feel that, you know, the comments are a bit overreaching in getting into the finer details of the fire departments and EMS departments that we essentially contract to go ahead and provide. If this was a county building, then I could understand it. But they're the professionals. They've had multiple studies done for this building and on two separate occasions and have professional firms come in and do it. If it was a county project, I would probably stick my nose in and say, you know, whether it's right-sized or not. But, you know, similar to when we were talking about the ALS building, that would be a county project. I could see managing it from our side. I do think comments from Dan Raley and Todd are, Commissioner Morgan, are spot on, that this, no matter how you look at it, it's going to be revisited, and it takes time to plan and put the money aside for this building. So, yeah, that's basic comments that I have on it. And, you know, I intend to support, as I already made the motion, what's on the table.
Mr. Jarboe, you have anything?
Yes, thank you, I do. I guess my point would be, we were requested by the community, by the fire districts, to increase the tax. That tax request went to the Rescue Squad Association, who unanimously supported it. It went to the fire chiefs of St. Mary's County, who unanimously supported it. Everyone agrees that the current apparatus that goes into Company 6 has to be modified in order to fit into the building. I don't think there's any doubt that they need a new building. There may be some question as to whether the new building, there's cost increases that are unknown at this point, but they cannot possibly go on contract to buy a new building unless they have their finances in order. To say that you'll fund them for 50% or anything less than what they're currently asking for is the commissioners putting themselves ahead of the professionals who came up with the numbers and the requirements. And I think it's completely arbitrary, and I won't support it. I support the vote that's on the floor, and I would request, Mr. President Guy, please call the vote.
Okay, I have a first and a second for the present fire tax increase and rescue tax. Roll call vote. Jarboe?
Yes.
O'Connor?
Yes.
Hewitt?
No.
Morgan?
Yes.
I have to say no.
Yes.
But it's a 3-2 vote. Motion carries.
Motion 6. I move to approve and execute the revenue ordinance for fiscal year 2019, which sets the tax rates.
Second.
I have a first and a second.
The delay.
Commissioner Jarboe, your vote?
Yes.
O'Connor?
Yes.
Mr. Hewitt?
No.
Mr. Morgan?
Yes.
And I vote yes. 4-1. Motion carries.
Motion 7. I move to approve and execute the appropriation ordinance for fiscal year 2019, which identifies appropriations.
Second.
O'Connor, second.
O'Connor seconds, okay. Okay, have a first and second on motion seven. Jarbo, your vote?
Yes.
O'Connor?
Yes.
Mr. Hewitt?
No.
Mr. Morgan?
Aye.
And I vote aye. 4-1. Motion carries.
And lastly, motion number eight. I move to approve the fiscal year 2019 budget as set forth in the schedules and documents included in the submission and execute the budget estimate page evidencing our approval of the itemized budget.
Seconded by Commissioner Jarbo.
O'Connor, second.
Commissioner Jarbo got first. Jarbo. He seconded.
Jarbo.
I have a first and second. Commissioner Jarbo, your vote?
Yay.
Commissioner O'Connor?
Yay.
Mr. Hewitt?
No.
Mr. Morgan?
Yes.
And I yes. 4-1. Motion carried. I think that concludes all of our motions.
It does.
Thank you, ladies, very much for all your help in putting this together. A lot of hard work went into this, and I appreciate it very much.
Thank you.
Okay, next, looks like we go right into county administrator time. Is that correct?
Thank you, Commissioner President Guy. And so, commissioners, I bring your attention to the draft agendas for May 22nd and June 5th. Just a reminder, there is no meeting of the commissioners of St. Mary's County on May 29th, 2018. So next week is May 22nd. You begin at 9 a.m. at the Metcom offices in California for the joint meeting between the commissioners of St. Mary's County and St. Mary's County Metropolitan Commission. You return to the Chesapeake Building in this room at 11 a.m. for your regularly scheduled business meeting. You have four proclamations: National Skilled Nursing Care Week, National Nurses Week, National Public Works Week, and National Safe Voting Week. You also have a presentation for the Department of Economic Development's Tech Book Artist. And also at 11:35 is scheduled from the Department of Human Resources to request a public hearing to introduce the Sheriff's Office Retirement Plan 14th Amendment. You adjourn that afternoon. A reminder that I mentioned, no meeting the following week. So the draft meeting agenda moves to June 5th. You begin in this room at 9 a.m. with a proclamation to recognize the retirement for Catherine Shoemaker. And then you also have your Board of Health meeting. The public hearing is scheduled for 10 a.m. with the Department of Human Resources to introduce the Sheriff's Office Retirement Plan 14th Amendment. And then you also have the decision regarding your public hearing this morning on the proposed amendment to Ordinance Number 2017-15 to provide an exemption to the impact fee ordinance for replacement dwelling units under certain conditions from LUGM. You also have an executive session scheduled that morning, boards, committees, and commissions discussion, as well as tentatively scheduled a litigation item. That afternoon at 1 o'clock, the Department of Recreation and Parks will host the ribbon cutting ceremony for the 5th District Park. So for this morning's business meeting, we begin with the Department of Economic Development for the transfer of bond allocation authority. Chris Castellimas presenting this morning. Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning, Commissioners.
Good morning, Chris.
Morning again. Today we're asking the board to approve a transfer of bond allocation authority to the Maryland Department of Commerce and the Maryland Department of Housing and Community Development. Each year, the Department of Commerce notifies the county of the amount of bond authority that can be used by the county or transferred back to the state. The total amount includes a portion for housing and a non-housing portion. This year, the state notified the county that the allocation amounts were $1,720,048 for non-housing and $4,013,445 for the housing allocation. It's recommended that the county transfer the allocations back to the state, which has been the practice of the county in the past. The housing allocation allows the state to fund housing programs or issue mortgage credit certificates. As a reminder, these allocations are simply bond authority limits, not actual bond funding. Our bond council recommends continuing the practice of returning the bond authority back to the state. This protects the county's debt affordability level and also eliminates the county labor and costs associated with a bond issuance. In addition, these funds are available for projects in St. Mary's County. So just as in terms of activity for the Maryland Mortgage Program in 2017, there were 45 mortgages, and so far in 2018, there are 23 mortgages totaling $5,254,000.
Mr. Castellanos, this is an example of what I call red tape. Here we are in the middle of something we probably shouldn't be in the middle of. And it makes obvious sense economic-wise and to do this. Mm-hmm. And every year, at least for the last three, we've done this.
Right.
What do we got to do to change it? Just let these guys handle it.
Well, Commissioner Hewitt, every year they ask us what we want to do. So we do have the option to actually use this bond allocation authority ourselves. So in case there's something, there's a change, we could use it. So it's just an opportunity for us. It's a little bit of commissioner time, and it's a letter back to the state. So,
you think we maintain some flexibility by having?
Yeah, I believe so. Okay. It could be a change. I think some counties may want to issue those bonds themselves. I think for us, it doesn't make sense according to our bond council. So,
do most counties do it this way?
That's my understanding.
Okay. Yeah.
Because again, the programs, like for the ones that go back to the housing community development. They use that for mortgage programs down here in the county, so it does make sense. And our constituents are benefited by the program.
So it really doesn't make any difference about our housing authorities' monies?
No.
It wouldn't make any difference if we held it and managed it compared to what they're doing with it?
No, I think the state has a good program going, and again, it's available to St. Mary's County residents, so it benefits our residents.
Okay.
To have it done this way.
As long as it's benefiting our residents.
Absolutely.
That's a big thing. Okay. Any other questions, Commissioners?
I make the motion to approve to transfer the housing and non-housing bond allocation authority provided by the Maryland Department of Commerce back to the appropriate state agencies and have the Commissioner President sign the proposed letters to the Department of Commerce and the Department of Housing and Community Development and any related documents.
Second. I have a first and second. I want to hear from Jarboe and O'Connor first. All in favor, Jarboe?
Aye.
O'Connor?
He faded out.
He faded out? The rest of us?
Aye. Yes.
Everybody? Okay. We have 100%.
Thank you, Commissioners.
Thank you, Commissioners. And item C is from the Department of Finance for the approval of budget amendment to purchase equipment. Jeanette Cudmore, CFO, presenting. Good morning again.
Good morning again, Jeanette.
Commissioners, we received direction last week from you to help out the Department of Public Works and Recreation and Parks to purchase equipment in 2018 in lieu of doing an exempt financing for them and funding it over 5 years. A grade all is in Department of Public Works and Transportation for an estimated cost of $400,000. A beach cleaning machine and an aeration machine is in Recreation and Parks. In the total, for the BA is actually the amount needed is $450,000, and this is going to be coming out of your emergency reserve in FY 2018. And the current balance in your reserve is $509,000.
We had some discussions about this over the week, and the question is would it be better to take it out of fund balance? I mean, we're well above our fund balance policy of 15%.
Right.
And this commissioner reserve, obviously, it's for emergencies. So it doesn't make a difference if we take it out of one or the other.
It really doesn't matter. I mean, but at this point.
It does or does not?
It does not. So if you want to use fund balance, you can, but we would have to go, make that part of the assigned or use it now. But right now, whatever you don't use in your 18, we'll drop the fund balance anyway. So.
Okay, I guess what I'm wondering is, do we need a public hearing if we were to change something like that?
No, you have the appropriation, so we could use it that way.
And the answer to my question, it makes no difference. Okay.
It's just a different in process. But you do have the funding in your, and we are in May, and this budget is good through June 30, and mm-hmm. We do have one more salary sweep that'll be probably coming to you, I think, on June 5th is the date. So hopefully we'll have some funds, and we can replenish it. And if there is an emergency, we can, again, relook at some of the accounts and try to realign based on that. But using it out of the 18 Commissioner's Reserve is really probably the better.
Right, one other question, and I may have it for Mr. Dietrich, if he can join you.
Sure.
Good
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon, John.
Mr. Dietrich, you'd also asked for two dump trucks.
Yes.
And I guess what we did here, we split the baby. We gave you the grade all, but we didn't give you the dump trucks. What's that mean?
We'll make do with what we got. I mean, we don't have a choice. We did have one dump truck go down this week. Engine blew up. Our maintenance shop is assessing the damage, trying to figure out if we can rebuild it in-house, how we fit that into the budget.
Well, I don't want to be penny-wise, pound foolish here. So maybe what you can do in the next couple of weeks is give us some kind of an update. And again, how will it impact your operations? You know, we want these roads to be as, you know, clean as possible. So if you could just give us an idea of the impact.
Yeah, I think it's a great idea.
Yeah, mm-hmm. We'll do.
Good idea. Yeah.
Thank you.
Any other questions, Commissioner?
Mr. President, I move to approve the purchase of a grade all for the Department of Public Works and Transportation and the purchase of beach cleaning machine and aeration machine for the Department of Recreation and Parks by the use of $450,000 for the Emergency Appropriations Reserve and authorize Commissioner President Guy to execute the related documents.
Second.
I have a first and second. Commissioner Jarboe, are you still there?
Yes.
You're voting yes?
I am.
Okay. We must have lost our counter.
He's gone.
Yeah, yes.
Okay, rest yes. Of us? Yes, yes. Motion carried.
Thank you very much.
And thank you, Commissioners. Item D is a briefing from the Department of Land Use and Growth Management on the community assistance visit, and I will have a PowerPoint presentation. Bill Hunt is presenting this afternoon.
Welcome back, Bill.
Thank you. Good afternoon.
Joining Yvonne, welcome.
Yvonne Chalet. Thank you, Commissioners, Dr. Bridget. What we have for you today is a briefing on a visit by the Federal Emergency Management Agency that took place in St. Mary's on December of this year. The process begins, or the story begins, in 2017 when the county expressed its interest in joining the community rating system, which is part of the National Flood Insurance Program. The county has been a member of NFIP since how long, Yvonne?
1987.
And as a member, FEMA is scheduled to conduct fairly regular community assistance visits for the county every 5 years, but the last one we had was
2009.
So they're behind. So we did have this recent visit in conjunction with the CRS, but as a member of the NFIP, we are supposed to have them on a five-year schedule anyway. What the CRS does is recognizes and encourages community floodplain management activities that exceed the minimums in the NFIP. Floodplain management, as used in this context, refers to the operation of a community program of preventative and corrective measures to reduce the risk of current and future flooding. The idea is that if you take these extra steps, the premiums are reduced even further than they are with the NFIP. The objectives are fairly straightforward: safety, reduce human suffering, protect the environment, reduce damages to property and infrastructure, and avoid economic destruction and losses. This is a voluntary program. It's not something that the county has to do. When the team from FEMA came, to conduct this community assistance visit, they reviewed our floodplain management regulations, evaluated the permit review procedures for new development, reviewed our permit files, and reviewed the county enforcement procedures. And when we talk about enforcement procedures, we're talking about for development or violations of development within the floodplain, not throughout the county generally. What FEMA did while they were here is go through various floodplain areas of the county and conduct a windshield survey of the properties. What they found at the end of their stay was that we have a comprehensive plan review process, a strong mapping capability. From their windshield survey, they found certain kinds of violations, such as propane tanks that weren't tied down or flood vents installed in houses, but they weren't installed correctly. They noted that while the county has a code compliance process for reported and verified zoning violations, which could be used to report and get compliance with floodplain ordinance, which we do, we don't send the zoning inspectors out on a regular basis to look for violations in the floodplain. The county's zoning inspectors have an inquiry-driven process, as the commissioners are aware of. We wait for residents to report what they think is a violation, and then we investigate. And this was the major shortcoming that the FEMA group found, was that they thought that we should have a systematic process to inspect the floodplain properties to ensure compliance with the floodplain ordinance. That would be part of the NFIP as well as something that's required for the CRS. So there are approximately 8,500 parcels that are at least partially in the floodplain. We know this from our GIS mapping system. We could use the same process. What we could do is use the floodplain maps as a basis for a systematic windshield inspection process. We can divide the county into various zones that can be looked at by the inspectors as they're going about their other duties, or target specific areas. Just an estimate, we could probably cover the whole county this way in 3 years. These would be the kinds of things that would show up from a windshield survey. These were actually photos that were taken by FEMA, so these are taken from public property, but they point out some things that are found to be in violation, such as propane tanks that aren't anchored, flood vents that are too high. Then you also have the loose storage of materials. Any of this could be a hazard in the event of a flood floating away. The way that our proposed inspection process would work would be similar to what we have now, in that, except for the part that the inspectors would make the initial report of a violation. What the inspectors would do would be to go through the floodplain areas, note the address of a potential violation. Then they would use our regular process once we receive a violation that's verified through our normal process, which is to send a letter to the property owner explaining the potential violation, request the owner contact the inspector. That way the inspector will provide information on how to come into compliance. If necessary, the inspector is glad to meet on the site to discuss what the resident may not be aware of. After 30 days of the initial letter, if there is no response, we can follow that up by civil citation. Then the next step is to bring back to you the request for an action plan that would follow those steps that I outlined, which, just to repeat, is that we would divide the county up into areas that have floodplain using our GIS mapping capabilities. The inspectors would drive through these areas, and when they see from public property what they think might be a violation, they would record the address, send a letter of potential violation to the property owner. If that's responded to within the 30 days, which we hope it would be, there would be a way to come into compliance. If we didn't get any response, or if the resident didn't come into compliance and take care of the violation, they would get a civil citation, as is the case now with other zoning violations. And with that, they have a court date to go before the judge. This today is just to introduce this idea, because it's quite a policy change from what we have been doing, what St. Mary's County has always done, with the inquiry-driven process, the deficit model, where we are contacted, we don't go out looking. This would be different from that.
Okay. So we're going to actually be now tasked to go around all these floodplain areas and study how people are securing items? And
yes, sir. Yeah. And even though this was for the CRS, and we've never been told that we had to do this before, it actually is a requirement of the NFIP.
Wow.
And that is to say, we do have a floodplain ordinance, and complying with that ordinance is something that FEMA, through the NFIP, is expected to be looking at and should have been telling us about some years ago, because this process that we've been using has been in place for quite some time.
Does FEMA or whoever give you a list of how you tie these items down, for example?
Yes, sir. There are instructions for how to do that.
Things,
huh? Yes, sir. There are manuals or diagrams. Ms. Palmer,
you show pictures of like 40-foot contained trailers, camper trailers. So these things have to be, if they're on that site, they have to be secured a certain way to the ground.
There are ways that you have to do it. If you're in the floodplain, now you can move that potentially out of the floodplain. Because all we're talking about, some properties are partially in and partially out. So if you move the materials out of the floodplain, then you don't have to comply with the floodplain ordinance and the floodplain regulations. In some cases, you're entirely in the floodplain, so there you are. You have to do what the FEMA requirements are.
I think one of the things that people need to be aware of is that this is not something the county government is doing. This is nationwide. The NFIP and FEMA are looking very hard at, particularly as we have these hurricanes and tornadoes and the weather events of the last few years, particularly through the southeast and the named storms and stuff like that, is that the money that the federal government allocates to FEMA for flood protection and things like that is woefully under the cost of what they're paying out to fix properties. In the county here so far, we had two or three houses where folks have come in and they're in the floodplain, they want the houses lifted. So there's an example of a resident trying to work with the government to, you know, take their house and make it more safe and secure. So like I said, we don't necessarily have to like this, but this is a compliance requirement of FEMA, the National Flood Insurance Protection Program. It's being debated hotly in Congress right now, has been for the last 3 or 4 years, as to how much money they're going to be replacing inside that fund to take care of costs and things like that. And it's in particularly, while it's affecting us locally in the floodplains, it's the mass migration of folks to the shorelines, and then the houses not being built correctly, houses are built too low, hurricane comes in, 8 feet of flood, house gets washed away, people don't have or paid for flood insurance, etc. So this is a nationwide thing. So I just want the citizen to know we're not doing this because we want to, or being doing this because we're being told to. Is that a fair statement?
Absolutely. Would you agree?
Yes.
Yes.
Mr. Hunt, Michelle, nice to see you. I would say to you, as far as these propane, look, if I'm in a flood or a flood's going on and a boat passes by, I might jump in. Propane tank flies by, that's a different story. We should have some kind of regulation that, I hate to pick on a propane company like a Suburban Propane, they should be able to secure their own tank. That's not something I would require a homeowner to, because these propane tanks, I used to sell propane, there are many bombs per se, and Lord knows they have to be taken care of and they have to make sure they're safe. And I'm not sure that kind of thing should be the responsibility of whoever owns that tank. Because when a company puts a propane tank at your house, you don't own it. Unless you buy it, bury it, which is a totally different animal. But these ones we see, these 100-pounders that we see in the back of people's homes, the propane company should be remanded to figure out a way to bolt those things down so they're safe all the time. Secondly, I would oppose any fines of people. I mean, some people have it tough. It's not easy for everybody. And, okay, if they have a camper in their yard or something like that, I guess recommendations or some way other than an actual fine and taking them to court. I mean, it's all about safety. I agree we need to be as safe as possible. But as far as fines, I'm resistant to support that.
The system that we have now, when someone doesn't comply and they get the citation and they go to court, so far the cost is zero. That is, we don't issue a fine. It has to come from a judge, and Mr. Weisskopf is very good at talking with the person as they're entering the courthouse, because at that point they realize they've got one choice. Either agree and have the case put on a step docket under which the resident will agree to a certain timetable to get the compliance taken care of, no cost from the judicial system, or go in front of the judge, plead your case, and somehow try to get some kind of relief that way. But the evidence is very strong that you're in violation of the zoning ordinance at that point. Then the judge has several options. The judge can order a delay. The judge could order a fine. So far as I'm aware, if Mr. Weisskopf is behind me, he would know better than I. But I haven't heard of only one case of a fine when someone absolutely refused to do what he was supposed to do after being in front of the judge. He would rather pay the fine, which wasn't very much, than remedy his situation, which wasn't a floodplain case. So we are not after fines.
You get Mr. Weisskopf coming up.
In case you have any questions regarding the court process.
You find anybody lately?
Well, the way the ordinances have been set up lately, the fine is up to the judge. And it's been my experience when we go in front of the judges in district court, if it's somebody's first offense, more likely than not, the judge is going to order it remediated, but they're not going to fine them a large amount of money. Obviously, those are the cases we've had so far. If there was a person that was obstinate and, you know, making...
That's one thing, obstinate. But suppose they don't have the ability to pay. They don't have the money.
To pay a fine, or you mean to remediate?
To remediate.
That would be something I guess we'd have to discuss and see what we could come up with, what sort of solution.
Well, let's hope we have a dialogue.
Oh, I think we always do.
Good.
I think what the department strives for is compliance, not fines.
Right, I agree. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Very good.
These people in the flood area, are they required to have flood insurance? Not required to have it, but we're required to.
Probably if they have a mortgage.
If they have a mortgage that's federally backed under any type of program, then yes, they are required to have flood insurance.
They have flood insurance if they're in this floodplain area.
Yes.
We talk about compliance. This is down in Emerald Isle, North Carolina. I was seeing them put in a fiberglass pool, about a 16x32. They had 8 500-pound blocks of cement that they had put around the pool. They dug it out, set it in the ground, and put these blocks. They chained it to the side of the pool. And I thought, what in the heck is going on? That was part of their flood compliance. Even though it was a fiberglass pool, could be full of water and concrete all around it, they had to secure it. That was part of their requirement. I'm not sure we got the same kind of thing here or not in a floodplain area, but they had to put these 8 500-pound blocks and chain them to the side of the pool. Okay. Any other questions, Commissioners? Mm-hmm. Thank you very much for the presentation. Appreciate
Thank
it.
You.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you, Commissioners, and this concludes County Administrator's time.
Okay, Commissioner Stein, we'll start with Commissioner.
We have to turn this off.
Thank you, Mr. President. We had a great day today. We broke ground for the new library and Garvey Senior Center up in Leonardtown, an event that, or a process or a program that's been going on for some time now. We say goodbye to one of our historical stalwarts of St. Mary's County, Gracie Brady, and I personally just want to thank you, Gracie, for everything that you've done for all of us over the years. On Saturday, I had the opportunity to go out to the 50th anniversary of the 7th District Optimists, and there's 9 members who are still charter members who are still with them. And I just want to give the recognition to these 9 guys who have been out in the 7th for years, working for the 7th District Optimists, and just say thank you on behalf of all the citizens for everything the Optimists have done for this community, not just for the 7th District, but Project Graduation, for the things they do for the Blessing of the Fleet, all the other events you see the 7th District Optimists on. So I want to thank Bo Bailey, Eddie Bailey, Burr Bailey, Bob Bailey, Jimmy Bannigan, Russ Collins, Al Francis Guy, Bobby Koppel, and Bobby Russell for their years of service and support to St. Mary's County. Now lastly, we just finished discussion on the budget. And budgets don't always go the way everybody wants to. As we know, last week I voted nay to a budget that I voted yay to today because it was specific. And everyone has different opinions on a budget. But at the end of the day, the budget is what we have to use to run St. Mary's County. And as you can see, while we agree and we disagree, our job is to move the county forward one way or the other. And it has to be moving, as we all believe, in a positive direction. So the budget process is what it is. It is probably one of the most singular important things that the Board of County Commissioners do every year. And it takes a lot of homework and a lot of time to dissect
all the various venues and avenues of what everybody wants across the board. It isn't just one piece. It's a whole bunch of pieces. You got to put this puzzle together. I thank Ms. Cudmore and Ms. Stegman for what they do, the commissioners for doing their homework, for the citizens who have come out and told us how great we're doing, for the citizens to come out and tell us how bad we're doing, whole nine yards. But like I said, a budget's a budget. We got to live with it. We got to go forward. And while we can agree to disagree, at the end of the day, we have to go forward with a majority vote. And whether we're on the yay side or the nay side of all this stuff, we're trying to do what we think is best for the citizens of St. Mary's County. And as I say, welcome to a democracy. Thank you.
Very good. Commissioner Hewitt?
Oh, well, first off, I want to apologize for this lousy cold I have. It's a. I was actually doing some constituent services on Thursday on St. George's Island, who has a problem with floodplain down there. Mm-hmm. And some residents had gotten hold of me, and I had Senator Waugh and Delegate Ray and Zane from Department of Public Works. And what we got caught in a rainstorm. Oh, hey, look at this.
Keep going, you're doing great.
Point was, is we got caught in a rainstorm, and then I got in my air-conditioned truck, and two aspirins at night doesn't cut it. It's only gotten worse, and it's really miserable. But with all that said, we're working together down there. What I mean by that, Senator Waugh, Delegate Ray, the county, on trying to do something to help the people on St. George's Island. I'm also the county's representative to the Critical Area Commission. The reason I bring that up is that our last meeting, they had a video from Dorchester County, which most people know is right across the bay from St. Mary's County. And there was a man there, he's probably in his 80s, and he talked about, he was standing in water that was almost up to his waist, and he said, this used to be center field when I was a kid. The fact is we have global warming, or we have whatever we have going on that's causing these seas to rise. Now, good news for St. George's Island, we think we may be able to get a bond bill or maybe get some kind of funding to put a revetment in that would hopefully save them some of the issues they're having. When they have a really heavy rain, they can get up to a foot of water over the road, and there's up to 200 people who are trapped down there. So that's something we got to keep an eye on, and I appreciate Senator Waugh and Delegate Ray going down there with me. Secondly, went to the Chamber of Commerce Awards on, I think it was Thursday. It was a luncheon where they recognize people who have done good things in the county. And the point is, the economy is good in St. Mary's County. We're actually, I hate to use the term, thriving, but we're doing good. And that leads me to today's budget vote. I voted against several of these increases. It's because I've believed historically we've underestimated revenues and overestimated expenditures, and that we continually end up with fund balances, and that these monies that we come back to us could be used in areas to help people who need help. And I'm talking the elderly, the poor, the people on fixed income. There was no tax relief in this budget, so I couldn't vote for it. I'm a big advocate of lowering the homestead tax from 5% to 3%. That would have cost us about $70,000 this year. But what would it have done? It would have helped elderly people who are in their homes, been in their homes for a long time, not to have to pay that increase because the state tax assessor has come along and said your property has increased in value. So that is the reasoning behind the votes I take. I think we're going to have more money than we say we're going to have. I think we're going to spend less money than we say we're going to spend. And at the end of the day, there'll be more money. So I'd just like to mention that. Now, on a positive note, on Friday night, my wife and I attended the retirement of Judge Karen Abrams. Very popular judge, has done an excellent job. She's my neighbor. It's amazing the number of times we run into each other in the morning getting our paper. It's wacky. But I want to wish Karen well in retirement, even though the other day when I was getting my paper, she was driving to work. I said, this doesn't look like retirement, going in quarter after 7 in the morning. She says, well, I still have cases. Karen, you've done a great job. You're a great neighbor. Thanks for everything you've done. Thank you.
Tom?
Thank you. I apologize for being on the telephone and calling in, but I do appreciate staff
for making it work today. It was clear as a bell, so I could actually hear everything that's going on. So very good. I was coming down from Howard County Economic Development Authority. I was working with the state of Maryland. I had promised them previously about 4 months ago that I would teach. They were doing a class on trying to take Maryland investments abroad and doing foreign direct investment, my theme for St. Mary's County, so I felt like it was worthwhile attending. Speaking of judges, yesterday I spent all day at a table with two judges, Judge Chesser, Judge Stom, and the state's attorney. I had both American and our warden. I had some of their staff. And we spent an entire day in Annapolis talking about pretrial release in the judiciary hearings. Very interesting. I was definitely the one who was naive or ignorant of a lot of the conversations they were having. But I just want the citizens of St. Mary's County to know that what I told our staff or our crew from St. Mary's County before we left was it was a wonderful opportunity to be able to speak to them directly, to hear their thoughts and concerns. But more than anything, it was a wonderful opportunity to hear how St. Mary's County is listed with Montgomery County as being the two number one places who do community policing and pretrial release. In St. Mary's County, if I had a dime for every time I heard Major American's name mentioned, I'd have been a very rich person yesterday. He is notorious up there for the advances that he's taken for the county just in the last few years. And we have 3 years of data now. And I believe we'll be seeing him in Forest after a lot of conversation in my ear yesterday, looking for some money or maybe some support for a grant application to validate the tools and the assessments that they're doing to make sure that it's accurate. And I will say that compared to Kentucky, who we had someone from the state of Kentucky who came out, we have wonderful rates. We have failure to appear rates less than in the single digits. Failure to appear meaning the defendant shows up for court when they're supposed to. In Kentucky, it's about 30%. So, I mean, they're doing leaps and bounds here and using technology by texting defendants to make sure they show up on time. Simply just texting took it from the double digits to the single digits because people want to do the right thing, but sometimes they forget. So, again, to our team, the state's attorney's office, the public defenders, I met one of our public defenders yesterday, to our judges, to everyone who's involved in the pre-release program, thank you very much. It is an honor. I was very proudful to be with you yesterday with the A team for the state of Maryland. Thank you.
Cheers.
No, go ahead.
I did.
You already did.
I started.
You already did.
Must have senior moment.
John's not on it. Okay. All this calling got me confused. Who is here? Okay, thank you very much. Yeah, once the pre-release, I remember going to Annapolis all these years to Mako and hearing Americans. Opinions all the time, and everybody talking about how good we do with our pre-release programs here. He's done an outstanding job, and I'm appreciative to hear St. Mary's County is on top of all this. Just go through our budget process here. You know, this is the fourth budget that I've been through, and one thing we're required to do, required to balance the budget and hopefully stay within our means. Sometimes we don't quite get as close as Commissioner Hewitt would like us to get us to, but I think we do a hell of a job. And we have to provide, our primary job is to balance the budget and provide as best we can quality services to our citizens. That's our whole job. That's all we got to do. And I think this Board of Commissioners has done one hell of a job in the last four budget sessions to do this. And I'm proud of everybody here, and I'm very pleased. I don't agree with everything either, as was noticed today. But the budget has been approved. It's will become law here soon. And I 100% support everything we got here. That's the way it is. And I say, as Commissioner Morgan said, it's democracy. And we've all made our decisions. So I just want to say other things here, too, is I know the elderly, we have like three taxes already that they can apply for, which I've tried to apply for all three, but I don't qualify. And I think I'm the oldest one here, but I didn't qualify none of them. So that all being said, I'm glad that situations are what they are. I'm glad that life has given me the situation that I'm in right now. I love St. Mary's County, and I appreciate being living here. And my gosh, this morning was a great thing when we did a dedication to the groundbreaking for our new library and senior center. It's going to be a great thing, and I'm proud of this board that we've stepped forward with this. At this time, we're going to go into recess. We have a Mako presentation at 2:30. Is that correct? Did I get the right time there?
Yes, that's correct.
Okay. Into recess now. Thank you.